जस्ट कमिंग, लेबर का गोइंग, जस्ट कमिंग।
ओके आई थिंक लेट्स स्टार्ट। सो गुड इवनिंग लेडीज, आई एम सुपर एक्साइटेड टू वेलकम यू ऑल टुडे, अ लवली वंडर वुमन, बैक टू आवर सीरीज ऑफ ऑनलाइन इवेंट्स एंड रिज्यूमिंग आवर सेशंस ऑफ इंटरेस्टिंग टॉक्स एंड वर्कशॉप्स एवरी थर्सडे 5 to 6 PM. We are taking up the first session today with the digital book launch of Shravan Swar Darshan. So this is the book written by our Wonder Woman Shalini Modi, who is also a very dear friend of mine. And this book is very amazing, with interesting tales, chants and of temples. And though I've read just the first 3 chapters till now, it seems like a very intriguing book, and I think everybody should buy it online through Amazon and have a look at it. So today's session, we will be discussing about this book in depth and knowing more about the author, Shalini Modi. This session would be moderated by our Wonder Woman, Sonali, who is also a yoga, wellness, and mindfulness coach, and also a keen enthusiast of the subject of the book. So without taking much time, ladies, let's start today's session, and over to you, Sonali and Shalini. But before we start, I just want to ask Shalini that since we've known each other for a very long time, so what thought came to you when you thought that you would write this book, or who inspired you, or what inspired you to write this book? Over to you.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. So it's a good question, Arpana. Basically, I always wanted to write, especially when I would see so religion and old always intrigued me, and especially them, you know, a pain to follow or do something, or would find them meaningless. I would reach out and gain the symbolism and meaning, and then it made sense to them. So that really inspired me to put down this book. And the other reason was that I was studying astrology, and I realized that most of the people, if they get their charts read, they don't want to know what the problem is. They want a solution. And, you know, revolves around solution to. And that's the reason I wrote the book. And of course, my friend Monica really encouraged me as well. She's an editor of the book. She's the editor. So she really encouraged me as well.
Very nice. Thank you. Okay, Sonali.
Yeah, I think I'll get started. Hi and good evening, everyone, once again. Really good to be here as part of the Wonder Women Connect. And I think it's a wonderful initiative that Arpana is taking up to have these Thursday sessions. And I think if more and more people can join in these sessions, it's going to be, you know, much more fruitful for everybody with their videos on and a more interactive session. And I'm sure today's session is going to be very interesting. So I would request everyone, if you can, you know, keep your videos on and really join in the conversation so that you can understand what the book is all about, since we have the book launch today. And first of all, I would really like to thank Arpana for giving me this opportunity to take up this interview with her friend. And I'm meeting Shalini for the first time, but Shalini, I've started reading the book, and I think I have kind of hooked on to the book, and I've been listening to the chants since yesterday on the net. And so it's a very interesting book, guys. Yes. And in today's session, we are going to be discussing more about this book. So it's going to be very fruitful and interesting discussion about the book. Well, about a little bit about me, Arpana already mentioned, I am a yoga, wellness and a mindfulness coach. And Shalini, just for your information, I have a very, very strong inclination towards chanting mantras. So if you look at my page, last couple of months, I have been chanting a lot of mantras and, you know, posting videos around it. Yes. So, but I haven't chanted like very difficult ones. Some mantras which are very close to me. So I chant them. I take them in my classes. So when Arpana told me about this book, I was like, I jumped in. I said, yes, this this you know subject really interests me, and I think I would love to read the book and know more about it. So and I've read the book. I think it very, very beautifully sews together the stories that you have put on from the you know old scriptures, the chants that you have put in there, and very, very interesting information that you have written about the temples. I think it's a very good read, and that's what we are going to be discussing today, more about the book. So before I go ahead talking to Shalini about specific questions around the book, a little bit of intro about Shalini. So Shalini is a very special storyteller. I think a lot of you would know that, who know her since childhood and, you know, who are aware of what she does. So she's a very special storyteller, and she's been fascinated by mythological tales since childhood and was drawn towards spiritual practices as she was growing from an inquisitive girl to a curious young girl, asking questions on human life, its purpose, and ways of improving it. So this led her to pursue her own chanting practice, which she started learning Vedic chanting. And with a lot of fervor and zeal over down the years, her interest in astrology also grew in leaps and bounds. And I think that's what led to her writing this book also. So armed with this knowledge, this insight, and the philosophical analysis, she has embarked on her journey as an author with her first book. So this is Shalini's first book, which is titled Shravan Swar Darshan, Tales, Chants, Temple. So if you read, every chapter is rooted in Hinduism, and it combines Shalini's own personal experience to accord belief a completely fresh dimension to, you know, spirituality, astrology. If you read, you will, the book is written in such a simple language that you will be really inclined to, you know, read each chapter and know more about every god, the chants related to it, and the temples related to each god. So I think that's a little bit of intro about the book. And now I'll start with my first question to Shalini. Which is, so I don't have the book, Shalini, right now, but I managed to take a print of the book, which I think...
That's nice.
If you can show...
I have one here with me.
If you can show it to everyone, yeah. If you can just show the book to all our audience here, at least even if you have kept your phone switched off, guys, please have a look at the book cover, because the book cover is really attractive.
I do have it. It's not with me right now. I do have it.
No, this is the book, you know.
Yeah. So it's a very attractive and a very beautiful cover, Shalini. So my first question, I'll start with that. How did you finalize this beautiful book cover and the book name? And, you know, what is the story or the idea behind this book cover and the name of the book?
Sure, Sonali. Thanks for the introduction. And, you know, there's an English idiom which says that don't judge the book by its cover, which means that, you know, the outside of a person or anything does not tell you about the inside. But I feel when a book is concerned, it literally can really tell you about the book if it's well thought of. And I put in a lot of thought into the cover of the book. So you see there are these three lines here, and they symbolize the three netras of Shivji, the three eyes of Shivji, or you can even say the three lines of ash on his forehead. And then this semicircular orange bindi basically symbolizes the Ardhanarishwar form of Shiv and Parvati. Each one of us also have partly the male and the female energy in us. And this symbolizes that. Again, you know, like the three eyes of Shivji again has three spheres. So number three is very important in Hinduism. You'll see, you'll realize there is a trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. There are a lot of things which are, and it's also a weapon that's used by Shivji and by the fierce form of goddess. So there again, both male and male energy. And if you see the little checkered, they look more like a chessboard, the black and white, but they actually symbolize the doors to the temples. So many, many doors to the temples. And if you go to any Indian temple, a door is very important. And they're not just one door, they're many doors. And they're very old sometimes. So this symbolizes going into the temples. Now coming to the name. So we have Shravan, Swar, Darshan. So Shravan, being the oldest paramparas or ways of passing knowledge for generations. So initially, nothing was documented. There was no script initially. And it was basically, the first storyteller was Shivji, who told the story to Parvatiji. The animals heard it, the sages heard it. And it just kept getting passed on generations till finally it was documented. So Shravan is connected to the tales that I put in the book. And then we come to Swar. So Swar means the sound. Now the sound vibrations cannot be underestimated. Whether you're talking to someone, you're shouting, the words you use, you're scolding someone, you're happy about something, they all cause a certain kind of sound vibrations in the air. And that results in whether the wellness or bad atmosphere, good atmosphere, they're very important. That's why so much importance has been given to mantra chanting as well as to, if you know Om, is now accepted even in the West. It's considered to be a universal sound. It is supposed to have a magical effect inside. It's supposed to open up your chakras. It has a lot of relevance. And similarly, every chant has been researched by so many sages. So, the dhvani or the sound of mantra chanting has a lot of power. So that's why swar connected to chant. And then we come to darshan. So darshan could be simply a ritual of looking at God. And that's why it's connected to a temple, which I've mentioned in the book. But darshan also means philosophy or something you ponder upon. But here I've basically connected them to temple. So it's connected to looking at God.
So darshan can also be interpreted as the darshan of the temple? The darshan of the temple, maybe?
Ali, you're absolutely right. So because it's a ritual of just looking at God, so that's why it's connected to a temple, because you go to a temple to look at the God idol, parallel meaning, which means philosophy. So something you ponder upon, you think about.
Okay. Interesting. I think Shravan, as part of Shravan, the stories that you have covered are like really interesting to read. I've read through 3-4 chapters and the stories are really, makes a lot of sense. They're very logical for you to understand why we follow certain rituals to.
You're so bang on, Sonali. Sorry, I'll interrupt you there, but you're absolutely right. So when I was studying I realized that some people were clients, and when I told them the story with the chant and they narrated that to their client, it had more effect on them, almost like a placebo kind of mentally connects the two. So that's why I felt that a story which has a background to a chant becomes more powerful, because then your chant,
now for example, I think you have covered a lot of rules that we follow today, for example, related to Lord Ganesha, or why do we worship Lord Shiva a certain way. So the way the script you have written down the stories, it makes a lot of logical sense to anyone who's reading, connect a certain thing today. So that's what, you talked about the swar part of it, the mantra chanting part of it. I also do a sound healing, Shalini. So I understand, what effect sound has on people. So I could totally relate 8 to 8 because mantra chant effect it puts on you and similar. The sound of a bowl or a metal, you know, what that sound, how you from insulin to name title of the book. So interesting. Let's move on to the next question. So Shalini said that you are an astrologer.
Absolutely.
So I wanted to understand, and for the understanding of everyone here,
sure.
Is this book on astrology, and if you can shed some light on, because there are a lot of myths around, attached to astrology and its accuracy. People just blindly start following a lot of, things, whether they understand it or not. So if you can shed some light on how the book is related to astrology and, how they can use it in that manner. Is my voice audible? Is my voice breaking?
Yes. So, simply address.
It's audible, but sometimes it cracks.
It is breaking, a bit. Okay. Must be the internet.
Breaking? I'll just change my.
So, regarding the astrology part of it, so the book, basically, I've used 12 different desires or problems that usually people face in their lives or things that they really want. So, like wealth or health, these are some common things. Healthy children, their well-being, education. So these are some of the things which are very, and that's the reason that I've given 12 chapters addressing these 12 problems or desires. And that's why I feel that they are connected to astrology in a way. I've also mentioned some of the planets and their how certain chants can be positive, or worshipping certain gods can give positive results. Regarding tough times in your horoscope. So, and where the myths of pinpoint events, they can be very specific, astrologers can tell you, and if they don't, then they get really upset. So that's not true. There is a promise in your chart, which an astrologer can see, and then they can give you time periods which are congenial for that.
Right.
And that doesn't stop at that. You have to work towards it. So say if you are capable of becoming a doctor or, becoming something, like, you have to work. If there's a genial period, you have to work hard towards it.
Yes.
Similarly, if there's a period congenial for getting married, then you need to try and look out. And then that period will help you further, aid you. Make sure that you get married. So, but you have to make your effort, and nothing is fixed. So, basically, our scope tells us about the karmic balance from last life, what we're carrying forward for so many lives, and what is the promise for this life. That's all it can tell. But fulfilling it is our, the free will always rests with us.
Okay, that's interesting. I think people who are into astrology will connect to the chapters and accordingly, take up the solutions as per their own, whatever solution they are looking for in their life. It could be health, wealth, and they can read the respective chapter and take up their solutions from that. That's what I understand can happen,
Absolutely.
Great. That's very, very good. So I also read, Shalini, that you have mentioned about four yugas in your book. And currently we all know that we are in Kaliyug. All of us know that we are living in Kaliyug. And in Kaliyug, the major problem that most people face today are the stress, the anxiety, depression that we have been hearing for a couple of years now. We've been hearing this issue so much in the news. And then, of course, the common ailments which are there, diabetes and cholesterol and, you know, blood pressure issues, hypertension issues we've been hearing. So I also understand that some of these issues can also be solved, not just by, like I read and I have been reading this, that not just from the medicine, but these are also related to our mental well-being. So what is your take on that? With respect to the book that you have written, what do you think, you know, how do these things can be addressed?
Absolutely. So Kal and Yug, basically, Yug is a period and Kal means the Yug of machines. So that itself explains that, you know, even humans have kind of become machines, and because we're always trying to better our lives, better ourselves, get more money, more everything. It's all of these problems, ailments, anxiety, stress, and more than food habits, more than a lifestyle, even mental peace is very important. So there are two chapters in the book which connect to mental well-being and, you know, worshipping Shiva. And there's certain chants which can help you calm your mind. I think the most important thing is, you know, meditation or any spiritual practice, all it does is basically gives you the power to calm yourself so that you can think correctly. Because when you're in anxiety or stress, you can't think correctly. You can't take decisions correctly.
That's right.
And it's very important to calm your mind, dress even what you're doing, like do it perfectly. And that's only possible. And also stress-free, like not strive, do all the hard work, but not always look at results. So, you know, make peace with whatever's happening. So I think, again, mental peace.
Yeah, and I think mantra chanting does help anyways. If people are into chanting mantras or doing meditation, I think that really helps you calm down and, you know, you really get a lot of peace through that. So,
absolutely. People, you know, some people might enjoy chanting, people might calm your mind, basically.
So, okay, Shalini, your voice is breaking. Is it breaking just for me or for everyone?
It's breaking for everyone, I believe.
Okay.
It's showing that her, you know, video is, the internet has a problem.
Okay, because at times the voice is, you know, just fading away. So I was wondering if it's just my...
No, it's been there for a while now.
Yeah, that's what I was wanting to check.
I'll just check one second. Oh.
Just check it once, Shalini.
I just checked. I don't know.
It's just breaking
okay,
in between.
But
so
I'm sure there is an issue.
You. For the most part, we are able to hear you, Shalini, but it's cracking in between.
Right. But here, I don't know, on my phone, it's showing fine. So I...
Okay. Never mind. I think we can continue. Yeah. I hope you're able to understand.
Yeah.
Most of it,
we are able to understand. It's just suddenly it cracks up.
Fraction of a few words which is breaking. Okay, so Shalini, I'm coming to my next question, which is specifically about the mantra chanting. And I saw you have used beautiful verses, long, beautiful verses of mantra chanting. So I wanted to understand, how can these chants be used by common people? Since these are not very familiar, they're written in Sanskrit. Sure. While I was also reading it, I was finding it a little difficult. So I just took the title of the mantra and just I played it on YouTube. So is there any other way you think, when common people, when any person
taking
up the book will start reading it, how can these mantras be taken up by them? And if you have a specific thing in your mind, thinking you can record audios around these mantras since you know about these mantras. So I don't know what the plan is, but some of them are like really long verses. So for someone, for a common man to connect to these long verses, you really need to, even though you've given out the meanings, but to correctly pronounce them and use them in their, you know, daily life is something that people will look forward to when they read the book. So what do you suggest, or, you know, just what is your opinion about it?
I agree with you, Sonali. Some of them can be quite daunting to begin with. But I would suggest that either you start with the smaller ones. There are some smaller ones as well. But also, like, audio recording, yes. So when I personally connect with astrology, I audio record and send them their specific chants and send them the script. So I send them the script and the audio chant so that they can do it together. But what you did was absolutely right too. A lot of people who bought my book and have back to me saying that they searched for it on playing. So they have done that as well. And that's a good idea, because initially, but that should only be used as a launch pad. Once you get the hang of it, you should let go of the aid, because it's not good, because any of the gadgets, they say, what I've learned in my Vedic chanting, in my astrology, is all gadgets are connected to Rahu. And when you're doing a spiritual practice, it's better to not use them. So initially, of course, it's very important. Even when I chant, we would record our teachers, play that along for a few times. So that's a good idea.
Shalini, even if you record it...
And someone who is really... Yeah.
Sorry, I think there is a network connection, and that's why...
No problem.
So I was asking, even if you record it somewhere else, Shalini, we will still be using an electronic medium to listen to it, isn't it? So...
Yes, so that's exactly why I said, Sonali, ki in the beginning, use that as an aid.
Okay.
Once you get used to the mantra, you know, many times, even though people get used to it, they just feel comfortable playing it.
Yeah.
But just, I would suggest then you stop playing it. Once you're comfortable, stop playing
it.
Till you need it, you should play it. For sure. Yeah.
And by that time, you if you start to, you know, memorize the chants, you can start, you know, speaking or chanting them yourself.
Coming along with it.
Okay.
Absolutely. Even if you can't memorize, you can always use the book. Using the book is not an issue at all.
Okay.
Because there are many long chants where you have to use the book. Like, I've not mentioned those long chants in the book. There are chants which are even longer, like, you know, they're called Sahasranams.
One chant and that very I powerful, saw it, which is 4 pages long.
They're basically 1,000 names. Yeah, so there are chants which are even longer than those. And they are called Sahasranams. So they're basically 1,000 names of different gods. So you'll have Vishnu Sahasranam for 1,000 names of Vishnu. You'll have 1,000 names of Shiva, Shiv Sahasranam, Devi, you know, so like that. In the South, in fact, you'll be surprised that children are taught all of these.
Acha, okay.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Mm. Surprisingly, we are never, you know, taught about these chants. I mean, it's very surprising that even though our culture is Hinduism, we are all, you know, follow the Hinduism culture, but none of us are really into, from the early age, we are not into chanting, and we don't understand these Sanskrit chants, which is not a good deal. So I think I'll move on to my next question. Shalini's screen is frozen, but I think I'm...
No, but we can hear her.
Yeah. I think
she's to it.
I think we'll... one last related question to spirituality and, you know, the things we have been talking about is, you know, do you think a life which is peppered with spirituality is much more fulfilled and a richer existence for everybody? Say around that.
I agree with you, Sonali. So spirituality, there's another funny phrase that I usually hear, where will say, oh, I'm not understand what they are really saying. They're just trying to be, I think, cool by saying I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. But actually, religion also is like a step towards that ultimate goal. There's only one goal of finding your true self. And these are all various steps to it. Some are baby steps, some are higher steps. So whatever suits you, whether a ritual gives you that connect and gradually can help you build towards other more subtle practices.
Shalini, you want to keep your screen off and then... You want to keep your screen
gradually keep rising above it.
You want to keep your video.
I can do that.
Just try that. Just keep your video off and then.
I can do that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's better.
Okay. So I feel that you are absolutely right that spirituality, definitely a life peppered with spirituality, is something which can give you a better experience. Because again, materialistic plane we are all living at. But this would just add, you know, another level of content, a calmness in your whole self. Because, you know, running after things is always there. But then if it's combined with calmness, with, you know, acceptance. So all of that, I think, is a part of spirituality. Is my voice fine, Sonali, now?
Is
it audible?
My voice is okay. Yeah.
Now it's okay.
Okay.
Video on, it was too much.
That's okay. So I think that, and also that that phrase that I was saying that usually people have a habit of saying, oh, I'm not spiritual, but I'm religious. So I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual, sorry. So that also, I feel people really don't know the meaning, because even religion, I feel, is a step towards the ultimate goal of finding peace. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Of basically finding, you know, anything that gives you a lasting happiness. Because if you notice, most of the things, most of the people don't give you that lasting happiness. So it's gradually just building muscle.
Biased, you know, unless, you know, you really, when you're following a religion and you really get biased or get too opinionated about few things, I think then it might stop your progress towards evolving towards your better self. And that is what the fine difference between, you know, religion and spirituality, I believe. But
I agree with you.
Yeah.
So you're right, Sonali, that getting opinionated, getting fixed in your ideas that this is right, this is wrong, and having a fixed view towards things, also getting attached to any practice you do and forcing it on others. Even you
that
know when you start feeling
as
it's
part of this practice.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So I think on this question, if anybody else has any view, your own experience, Poonam, Kavita, Arpana, anybody, if you want to, you know, what do you feel about being spiritual, or what do you think, you know, spirituality means to you, and what is that?
What Shalini had mentioned earlier, I had listened to her once the launch of that book before in on that Facebook thing, and I really liked what she said, that if it's been forced on you, you would retaliate, you will not like to follow it. So it's what she has mentioned in her book is not forcing yourself, and that she keeps on reiterating that no one is forcing you, just believe. If you have a belief, you will follow it. So spirituality, or it's not that, okay, if I'm just, you know, sitting in front of the God, then only I'm spiritual, otherwise I am not. It's not like that. It's in your heart, it's in your belief. What she has been saying all this while, that it's the belief, what makes you spiritual and, you know, follow the religion. It's not someone is forcing you. I really like that thing.
Good. Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Any other views anybody wants to share around this? I think otherwise people can read the book and know more about what we are talking about. Anyway, so I am now coming to a very interesting question, Shalini. How was your journey as a first-time writer? This is your first book. So, you know, what was the whole process of putting this book together and any difficulties that you faced while you started, when you thought of, you know, really that you were going to write a book and, you know, going to launch it? It's not an easy decision to make, I'm sure. So how was
this
whole process of, you know, was the process exciting? Was it difficult? Was it fearful? How was it? We would just like to know that about
so it was definitely exciting because it was, you know, towards becoming the first time author. And I always wanted to write for a long time, but I couldn't gather myself to do it. So I think this lockdown helped because I got more time. And then my friend Monica, who's the editor of the book, she kind of pushed me. So she was a big help. And she constantly kept making me believe in myself. Because after writing also, I almost scrapped the book, saying that, oh, I don't think it's worth enough. And one important thing that she mentioned about the book when I'd written it was that it's almost like a handbook for anyone. So it's not just a one-time read, but it's something that you can keep going back to. And that a lot of people have told me after reading that it's something that we can keep going back to when we need to in life. So, I think getting that across to people was very important for me. Also, I think I've written it in a very simple language, so a lot of people felt that that was an easy read, which, that really helped. Yeah.
And when you're looking forward to something, you know, the process might be very, very difficult. But when you're excited and you're looking forward to something, you put all your effort into it and you make it happen, you know, however difficult the process may seem. That's what I think.
Absolutely. I agree with you there.
Yeah.
If you believe in yourself, then you can do anything.
Yeah, sure. So, Shalini, what is your favorite part of the book? What is your favorite chapter? So, you know, what is your favorite verse? If you can read out something from the book, which is your favorite.
So I think for me, the synopsis at the end of the book, at the back of the book, I mean, my video is off. Storytelling or Shravan Parampara has been a popular concept for thousands of years. In fact, it was the only way of passing down events in stories. Documenting them started much later. Shiva told the first story to his consort Parvati. And when animals and birds heard Shiv Parvati Samvad, they narrated it to the sages, who foretold them to common people and so on. Our texts hold so many treasures, including powerful mantras, hymns, and chants written by great sages of the past, who have, with their severe penance and spiritual and yogic practices, attained the highest knowledge. The stories and hymns in our scriptures are connected to many beautiful ancient temples, which were built by sages and kings of the times on the spots of special power or where the idols appeared by themselves, thus called Swayambhu, one that appears on its own. So let's embark on this journey to discover these and see how they can help us to be better versions of ourselves. So I thought that this kind of just gave a little peek into the book.
Summarizing the whole book.
Summarizing the book. And I also thought that, basically many times people wonder why should we follow these old scriptures? Because there is no real science given to it. But we fail to understand that just like we are researching on a vaccine or on anything, even whether it's yoga, you're a yoga practitioner, Sonali, and you know, each asana, some of the asanas have names of rishis.
Yes.
And the reason that they have the names is because each rishi has spent years and years of sadhana to come to that particular asana and its benefits.
Yes.
And the same thing they've done with mantras also. So, actually, everything that's there in our old scriptures has been very well researched. And of course, it's our faith and belief that we have to connect with, because the research bit of it is not given. So that is something that is really left to our imagination. But it's almost like science. Everything that's been put in those scriptures so has a lot of science behind it.
I think that the in that sense, the book should be made, should be introduced as part of the curriculum and, you know, taught in schools.
That seems...
Yeah, that could be an idea, you know, because children will relate to these scriptures unless they, you know, they know about these ancient stories, what was written in our scriptures. How would they ever know about, you know, what we follow today or what is our culture and, you know, what was written ages back? And they will not make any sense out of it.
Yeah.
Anyways, the kids today are, you know, running after the Western world and, you know, so many things. This is something which is completely rooted in our culture, and I think some parts of this should definitely be made part of the school curriculum.
I agree with you. Even the yoga bit, I feel
yoga has become a very essential part in schools now. Suddenly, since the lockdown, yoga has been active in most of the schools. So let's see what happens eventually. So now, Shalini, that your first book is out, are you excited about writing another book or are you already writing another book?
So I've already written my second book.
Don't tell me.
And yes.
But that's interesting.
So the second...
What is it
the
about?
The second one is a little different. And it's, you know, this whole concept of scare of death, immortality has always kind of intrigued me because a lot of scriptures talk about Amrit, the Sagar Manthan, which led to Amrit, the immortality. So I've written about seven immortals who are considered to be, there's a shlok which names them. Some of them are Ashwatthama and Parshuram ji, who's a Vishnu avatar, and Kripacharya, who's a Kulguru of the Kauravs. So like this, there are seven of them and they're all very interesting characters because they all have achieved great heights in their lives. But they've either been cursed or they've been blessed to live on till a Pralaya comes. So that's why I found that a very intriguing topic.
Are they still alive?
Pardon?
Are they still alive?
Yes. So they're meant to be alive. They're meant to be around us. And each one has a purpose in life. And some people claim that they've seen, like Tulsidas ji has supposedly, you know, seen Hanuman ji. And Ashwatthama has been seen in Madhya Pradesh and those areas. He has been seen around the Shiv temple, which he had made after being cursed. So I just felt the lives were very intriguing. And also I've then given a little fiction part to it. Yeah. Sorry,
I'm saying just listening to it is so intriguing that, you know, you would really want to know about these characters and to really believe that they are alive and they're around us right now. It's like,
yeah,
unbelievable, but you know that that's the truth.
Yeah, that's what's been written. And the other thing is even what intrigued me was whether being immortal is really something that they are happy about. So that's where I put in the fiction part, where I've given their point of view, that whether living for so many years, are they happy about it? Because you see, if you, I heard from a friend how his father's contemporaries had all died. Yeah. Even a servant who was his age, who has been there in his service for long, had died. And he was all alone because his children were abroad somewhere. So he, his eyes were failing, can't watch television. All the contemporaries gone. Would you really want a life with all your children, all the younger people, everyone gone?
It's unimaginable. Really,
So that's why somewhere this whole concept of mortality and that life and death circle is probably, you know, it's like a blessing in a way.
I'm sure it's going to be very, very interesting read. So when are you planning to launch that book, Shalini? Is it almost over or
you're still the book? The book is over. It's in editing and I'm trying to get a publisher this time because this the first book was self-published. I didn't try for a publisher. But now I've just realized that marketing becomes easier if you have a publisher.
Yeah.
You know, then you can concentrate on writing.
And then with a successful first book launch, I'm sure the second one will definitely get a publisher.
Yes, I hope so. So that's the idea, Sonali.
Great, 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 Shalini. I think, thank you so much, Shalini. Before we close,
thank
I think
you, Sonali.
I'd like to ask all the audience if they have any questions around. Okay, so we have a question from Rachna. If anybody has a question from Shalini around the book or any of the related topics that we spoke about, I think please feel free, guys, to switch on the videos, or even if you don't switch on the videos, you can switch on your audios and ask your questions from Shalini. Anything that you found interesting during the discussion, anything related to the book?
So I would like to say this, that, you know, I have been going through this, and when my kids were here, you know, so I was just telling them about the book and all, and it's so interesting. In such a simple manner, in such a simple language, she's, you know, spoken about all the gods and all, which from me being a Jain, from Jainism background, no, so I didn't know much about Hinduism. For me and my kids, it's like a wonderful book to read and go through. So that is a very interesting thing which I would like to share. And I think everybody should go buy the book. It's very, you know, it's written in a very simple manner. Things, even I think most of the Hindus are not aware of it, you know.
Yes. I'm sure, Arpana. A lot of Hindus.
You can share with your kids, you know, they should have this kind of a knowledge.
Yes. So, we can share with the kids also. It's that, you know, that simple book can be shared with the kids.
Yeah.
Poonam, you were saying something.
These things, I was just noticing, and this thing is really good what she's come up with. And these things, these values are diminishing in the society somewhere. So I feel I feel that I'm going to buy this book as soon as possible, go through it, and I would love to read it. I would love to read this book, and I will make sure that my kids also go through it.
Order on Amazon after the session.
I'll do that. I'll do it.
In fact, we'll put it in the YouTube link also. YouTube, we'll put the Amazon link.
So yeah, exactly.
You can buy it on Amazon.
Because it's very important for us to go back to our values. It's very important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True.
Yeah, I want to add, you know, thank you so much, you know, for the lovely session, you know, which we had, you know. I said this is a turbulent time, this COVID time where, you know, everybody is so lost. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this book will definitely make a difference. You know, once we'll read, we'll strengthen our roots. That's more important, you know.
Yeah.
The fear factor is so much in life, you know, we don't know what to do and where to go.
Yes.
And what step to take. So I'm sure, you know, and they should, they must, you know, include this book in the school curriculum so that, you know, the most of us, we really don't know about our culture.
Yeah, you true, Rachna.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah,
and you can switch on your video now.
Oh, yeah, you can switch on your video.
I'm standing in the balcony and, you know, saying there's so much of internet problem here.
Yeah.
Just by reading those words, you know, you get a lot of power and strength, I believe. True. Just by reading those textures, what you have written, Shalini, gives you a lot of power and strength. So like Rachna is mentioning, in such fearful times when people are so much anxious and fearful, if you just read those lines and you start believing that, yes, these chants are going to make difference, they're really going to help you calm down at specifically at this time.
Absolutely. I agree with you totally there.
Yeah.
And it's a practice that you just kind of build over.
Yes,
you
know, true.
Slowly and gradually. It's
so. Any other questions?
Yeah, hi. Yeah.
Hi, who is this?
I'm Neeta here. I'm Shalini's friend. Yes, I would like to add that, you know, these days we have got so hooked to the everything on the, like, you know, either Google or YouTube, or, you know, our concentration of reading has completely gone. But this book is, you know, it's so engrossed. We get so engrossed reading this book that we want to read it over and over again. Maybe the first chapter I have already read 3 to 4 times. So this is the best thing about the book, is that it's very simplistic, but yet it is very captivating also.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this brings you back to, you know, our olden times when we used to actually read. And this habit had gradually gone, like, you know, we used to think, oh, we have to wear our glasses and we have to read something. So it's better to see it on a TV screen or, you know, an iPad. But this reading has really helped in concentration. And it is very interesting that sometimes your body vibrates. Like when you're reading, your body vibrates because you feel the connect.
True.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you, Shalini, for giving us that book.
Thank you.
So
thank
much
you,
of
Nita.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I guess we can wind up now. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Shalini.
And Shalini, for this wonderful book, and good luck to you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Next book as well. We are looking forward to reading that one as well. So.
Thank you, everyone, for joining in and listening to.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sonali.